Hello. Welcome to my talk. My name is Joseph Mbele. I'm a Tanzanian. I teach here at St. Olaf College in Northfield, Minnesota, in the English department. I've been here since 1991. And before this, I taught at the University of Dar es Salaam in Tanzania from 1976. So, welcome to my talk. Today, I want to speak about gender issues in Africa. The reason I decided to talk about this topic is that recently there's been a lot of controversy about gender issues and sexuality issues in Africa, especially with the rise of the LGBT movement. The LGBTQ plus agenda, and I know it's a very tense controversy, and I have decided I need to say something about it, but today is not the time for me to address this topic. I'm still studying it. I still have some homework to do. But the debate itself has made me think very intensely about things I have written in the past about gender issues in Africa. So as the debate continues to rage, I'm thinking about what I wrote in this book, Africans and Americans, Embracing Cultural Differences. It's a book I published in the year 2005 here in the USA. And there's a section, there's a whole chapter on gender issues. Starts on page 61, and I will read a section from this chapter. Before I do that, I should say the book has been very, very popular among Americans. It was initially used in study abroad programs run by many American colleges and universities. For example, the Associated Colleges of the Midwest, about 14 colleges, they had a consortium, and they had these study abroad programs in various African countries. And there are really many other colleges outside of that consortium, and they all used this book as a cultural orientation resource for students. I'll get back to this later, but let me read the section I have in mind here. This is what I wrote, and this has been read, you know, by people for all these years. This is what I wrote about Africans. The whole book makes generalizations about Africans and generalizations about Americans, but but that's a topic for another day. My generalizations have not been challenged, and this is one of those. So let me read. Africans take it for granted that everyone, upon attaining the appropriate age, has to get married and have children. That's the statement. Africans take it for granted that everyone, upon attaining the appropriate age, has to get married and have children. And then I go on to say something that I picked up from African folklore. So here's what I say. African folk tales deal again and again with this theme. That is the theme of getting married and having children. In these tales, when a boy becomes a young man, he automatically goes looking for a wife or asks his father to do so for him. In the same way, when a young woman reaches the appropriate age, young men come to woo her. Sometimes the parents will make the decision to look for a wife for their son or a husband for their daughter. And then I make reference to a book that I published earlier than this one. It's called Matengo Folk Tales. These are folk tales from my culture. I recorded them when I was an undergraduate student. I translated them into English, and here are 10 of those tales. And so I'm using the folk tales, the African folk tales, to underline the point again that the idea of a young man or a young woman growing up and getting married and having children is a part of the culture, the African culture. So, quoting from this book, Matengo Folk Tales, this is what I say. In Matengo Folk Tales, the opening statements of all the tales dealing with humans incorporate these themes. Here I mean the theme of marriage and having children. One tale begins, there was a man with 5 children. Another tale begins, there were once 2 women. Each of them gave birth to a baby. Another one begins, there was a man and he bore 2 children. Yet another tale begins, there was a man. He had no child. He just lived like that, childless. A Maasai folk tale called The Woman and the Children of the Sycamore Tree makes the same point in its beginning statements. And here's how it begins. There was once a woman who had no husband, and she lived for many days in trouble. One day she said to herself, why do I always feel so troubled? It is because I have neither children nor husband. I shall go to the medicine man and get some children. That's one paragraph in this book. The following paragraph starts like this. Once married, the African couple has to produce a child as soon as possible. If they don't, everyone wonders why. and relatives start seeking solutions to the problem. That's the African culture as I describe it in this book. I make the statement and then I make reference to the folk tales. And I could spend a long time talking about the significance of folk tales as a repository of the cultural values, as a vehicle for education of different kinds. So my point is simply to record this fact that I had said these things in this book, which has been for almost 20 years now very popular. It has been used by these colleges and universities that run study abroad programs as a cultural orientation resource. It has been used by congregations of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America. Many churches here in America of the Lutheran Church have been in partnership with African congregations, and they have been using this book as a cultural orientation resource. Many people within the Peace Corps program have been using this book. It's actually even there in the library of the Peace Corps program in New York. The book has been featured and recommended in various publications, church bulletins, blogs. It has been reviewed favorably, very favorably. It was even the subject of a seminar that I gave here at Central of College, a faculty seminar. It was a very well attended seminar. You can read about that seminar if you Google three words: Institute, Freedom, Mbele. Mbele is my name. If you Google just those three words, you will read a report of the seminar that I conducted. More than 50 members of the faculty at Central Love, they read this book. We had a great discussion. Read the report. So the claims I make about African culture and gender issues in African culture have not been challenged since 2005. I've never received complaints. There's not even been anonymous messages anywhere that I know of. So what is happening? What's going to happen now that the big agenda is the LGBT, the LGBTQ agenda? I don't want to get into that controversy. I'm just posing this question and wondering whether, as time goes, as this controversy continues, whether people will want to ban my book, whether it will be a forbidden book, whether it will be seen as not truthful. I don't know what's going to happen to this book, which has been so popular up to now. Again, I'm very curious, and as the debate rages, I'm thinking about what I wrote in my book. and wondering what's going to happen. Are people going to reevaluate it differently? Are they going to challenge what I'm saying? For today, I don't want to get into the controversies around LGBTQ. I know it's a very big controversy out in Africa. I know there's a lot of pressure coming from the West, the USA in particular, pressure on the Africans. I will address this issue another day. For today, I just want to record my anxiety and curiosity about how people are going to respond, you know, from now on, you know, to what I said in my book, which has obviously not been controversial up to now. So that's it for today. If you are interested in this book, you can get it online, www.lulu.com. www.lulu.com. Thank you. Have a nice day.